Good afternoon again. Next talk is about persuasive sonic design and artificial intelligence to prevent sport injuries. It presents insights of the Nano for Sports EUREG project. And originally, Olaf would have presented this talk, but last Monday he became a father. So congratulations to him. And we found Tom van Langhorst. He is researcher and lecturer at Fontes. He will, he's so nice to come in and take over his talk. So would you please welcome Tom?
Okay, thank you. Yeah, well, I'll try my best. So I'm also connected to this project. It's an EUREG project, as you just, and we work together with Olaf and Benjan, also here, and myself. But this is a project where we have knowledge partners. You see them on the left, and business or industry partners. You see them on the right, and especially we work closely with Steven, who's going to do a talk later, with Jos, and from the industry side, with Franklin. And I hope they're all here. No, they are not. Okay. Well, so what's the goal of Nano for Sports? The goal for Nano for Sports is to motivate people to improve their exercise technique in order to prevent injuries, sport injuries. And this is the overall goal, but we narrowed the focus down to amateur runners and to improve their positioning and movement in order to prevent injuries, sport injuries, by the use of personalized sonic feedback. So when you're running, you're anyway listening to music. What can we do changing your music that makes you run better, preventing injuries? And this also implies that we use AI, artificial intelligence. So, in a naive, you can look at our project like this. So we have a lot of sensors hanging around your body, maybe on your feet or at other places. We miraculously send data to the artificial intelligence that does really smart things with it and sends information back. So we change the music or the things you hear, and this will change you the way you move when running. That's the general approach. But of course, this doesn't work like that. Oh, yeah. How do we work in the reality? We have a lab set up where you see Benjan with a trash. A treadmill with 8-channel discrete sound system, so we can really make directional sound with it. And we have complex and advanced sensors. So we check our hypothesis and our theory there, and the learnings we use in the right side, the field setup, everything that fits into a bag and you can wear when you're running to give you feedback. Okay, those are the two approaches. What are we going to do with it? First of all, or on the left side, we want to convert the steps you take into audio. This is called sonification, and this can give you information about the quality of your running. And on the other hand, you are anyway listening to music. Can we change the music in such a way that you start to move differently? And in the end, we try to bring those two together, add a little bit of gamification with it, and then we have our final solution. So that's the whole idea. Well, this is our first project or prototype, where Benjan, you will see him on the right, and you will recognize his feet. He starts running, and most of the time you run to the music, but now you generate music from your steps, the steps you make. Okay, and you see that when the tempo of your steps change, also the tempo of the music changed. Well, this is our first prototype, and you see Benjan is a real composer. Now, when we measure your movement while running, everything about your running is in the sensor information. So the whole step, the contact time on the floor, on the street, the swing time, so when your leg is moving around, everything is there. Well, that's the theory. In practice, it's a little bit more complicated. It depends very much on the quality of the sensor and where you locate the sensor on your body. the most accurate measurement you will get when you place the sensor on your foot. But you will also get a lot of disturbance when you place the sensor on your foot. So more stable sensor data you will get when you place the sensor on your, yeah, around here. Nevertheless, even though it looks like a difficult task to measure steps, student projects prove that it can be done, even by students. In a day, I should say that. So they built this in a day and it recognizes steps. When walking, but also you see, and this is the first time I saw our students running. Actually they start running now and then it still detects the steps. So great, great. Now, you can measure one step, but it's also interesting to measure more than just one step. And then we're talking about the cadence. Huh? So how many steps do you take per minute? You can approach this problem by three different methods. So directly from the sensor data, with the threshold measurement, for example, but also with autocorrelation, which calculates the most important frequency or the base frequency, and also with fast or Fourier analysis or transformation or wavelets. So they all collect the rate or the frequency of your steps. And we did all three of those, with validated research data set from Sweden with, I think, about 30 people running and walking. So it's a large data set. And we applied to those three methods on the data set. And you see consistency in what we measure in both three methods in the tempo, the cadence. With all those are four people. That's interesting. But when you look further into this data, you see there's a lot of jittering going on. And now the interesting question is the jitter caused by noise? Is it the noisy signal, so randomness? Is it random or is it fractal? So are there actually patterns in this jittering data which have a certain flexibility? That's what we call fractal. And the funny thing is, it's not noise, it is fractal. And there is research done and literature that proves that. So in this jittering, there is flexible patterns going on, and actually those patterns can tell you something about the emotional state of the one who is walking or running. That's really interesting. Keep this in mind. So, interesting. So we had some learnings. It's not so easy to use sensors, and you have to. They have to be of a good quality. You have to consider where you put them on the body or how you wear them. And but there's a lot of knowledge, domain knowledge about steps and walking and running. But there's also a lot of argument about the evaluation of this data. And there are a lot of solutions already focusing on what I call the subtractive manner to analyze data. So we choose another approach, not so much depending on where you put the sensor, or not so much depending on the quality of the sensor, and leaving out all those discussion, and let the AI do the work. So how do we do that? The first step is recognize what your activity is, so human activity recognition. There are a lot of algorithms already there that do exactly that, and to a larger extent than just walking and running. So we built just one simple algorithm, well, simple convolutional neural network, to recognize three different states. You're running, you're walking, or you're doing something else. So, and it's a convolutional neural network. So the input is the signal you already saw. Then we chunk it into little parts, do some filtering, and let the system learn. And it's using this this data set already. And the only thing we have to take in account is that the time of the sensor data is important in the system, and that's why we have to add the LSTM, so long short-term memory. And the outcome you see on the right, this is and the accuracy of our algorithm is above 90%, so it is capable to recognize if you're running, if you're walking, or doing something else. And of course, we tested this. This is Olaf running. No, he first walks, and you can see the streets where he did it in Eindhoven. And he starts walking, and at a certain moment, the algorithm says, you're doing something strange, you're not walking or running, and it's called a turn, but we don't care about what is, whether it's a turn or is doing something else. Coffee drinking is also not recognized by our algorithm. And then he starts running, and we recognize that as well. Well, this is all on the level of general states recognition. So it doesn't say specifically something about the manner in which Olaf walks or runs, but it in general says how whether people run or walk. And that's, well, remember our goal, we want to have a personalized system, so we want to achieve a state where we can do, or when we can have conclusions on an individual level. And there are systems that do exactly that, but they have to do with security. And they use visual data to identify you, for example, Marcel, and we identify this is the movement typical for Marcel. So this is Marcel, but it's always based on visual data. But we want to use our sensor data, like the gyroscope and the accelerometer, that's the word I was looking for. And this is what we're working on right now. So what we do, or what we have to do, is take all these steps, which are similar but not equal, and have to find a solution to make them comparable to each other. So we now mapped different steps on each other. You see they are different, they are similar but not equal. And then this work starts, and this is how we think about the solution which we are going to use to identify a person by his or her movement. It's also a convolution neural network, but now the network is not learning to just recognize the three states of walking, running, and something else, but it's learning to identify the most important features in the data set we give the algorithm, which is the validated data set. And it looks, well, this is a sort of visualization, so think of all the features that the system recognized as one of the squares, and you see many squares, so there are many features that the system recognizes in the data set, but we don't know, so they are not descriptive. We don't know what the features exactly are. Okay, but the top left is the most important feature the system or the algorithm found, and to the bottom right is the least important feature the algorithm found. And the height map, hey, you see the sort of height map, is your personal data mapped onto the system. And in some squares you will find that your personal walking data is important in this feature, is recognized, and some squares are not so much important in your personal steps. So this is actually the DNA of your walking, of your running. So then, by this system, we think we are able to identify you as a runner. But, that's nice. This is how we think about the architecture of the software solution we are going to, or the more software solutions we're going to build. Of course, we have a back end where we do all the smart things with data, but the interesting part is to the right. So there we have the measurement units, and of course we have the step, and the steps have to put into sound, and then we have this FMOD, which I'm going to show in the next slide, which is an adaptive music or sound platform, which is also used in the game industry, that changes the sound according to the analysis done by the rest of the system. So we're working on that, and we already have some examples to show you, but we have also demonstrated here further away. Ben-Jan is there. So we have here the FMOD setup. It's integrated in a wearable solution, we have a model of footsteps. So that's the picture to the right, in the middle. It's a model of footsteps on gravel, and when you start walking, you hear the model sound, but also you hear some changes. So at a certain data or at a certain level, you hear a disturb. that the sound a little bit disturbed. So it signals you that you're not running okay. That's. So it follows your cadence, and it gives you information about the quality of your steps in a simulation way. So this is called sonification. A next example is that we add music, and actually we do two musical elements or categories. First of all, is you can imagine when you take a step, then this might be the beat, but you can also fill in the time between two steps, and this is called rhythm. The density of the rhythm. So you can do it like this, doom, 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 doom. That's how most people walk. But you can also add things in the time spaces between steps, doom, 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 like that, or maybe three. Well, you can think of all kind of combinations, and that's what's happening here. And also, what we do is it's called the timbre. So the brightness of the music is also a parameter which we apply here. You hear the change in the brightness. Okay, well, it's just the first prototype, but it proves that we can take your steps and do something in music, and then we address something where music is very good at, changing your emotion. And the relationship between music and the perceived emotion is already very much studied. For example, studies of Gabrielson. And exactly that's what we are trying to address here. That rhythm density and the timbre addresses the arousalness of your emotional state. And the other thing, the expression, you know, this sound that starts to change and maybe sounds a little bit awful or awkward, is what we can describe as a musical expression. And this is then used to change your emotional state. Now, the one step we are missing, but it's coming up as you feel, is the relationship between emotion and your gait, the way you move. And this is already also existing evidence or in literature where it's proven that your emotional state influences the way you move. So, and this is an experiment done with a sort of same neural network where people are in a certain state of mind, in a certain state of emotion, and this is measurable in the way they move, in the way they walk. And even it goes a little bit further, that when you change their emotional state, so by listening to music or by self, how do you say, self, well, you imagine that you're happy, whatever, that's the way you move will change. So there's a direct relationship between the emotion and the way you move. And if we can address this this relationship by music, which has also been proven to change your emotional state, we have a working principle, and we are really working hard to make this working principle reality. That's what we do. We apply science, and that's what we hope to present to you next year: working solutions where your emotion is changed by the music in an adaptive way, depending on the what we measure, and changing your the way you move in order to help to prevent you from getting hurt or getting injuries while sporting. Thank you.